come back to the whole issue. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13 says, chapter 13, verse 13. Faith, hope, and love. And I want to think about it while Brother Bowman is speaking. Is there a connection to the faith we're talking about, the trust Brother Thorpe, and the hope that we're looking at? And how do we tie in love to all of this?
Okay. So we're looking at death, right? And dying. And we're looking at the hope that we will see God once we remain faithful to Him and once we continue trusting Him and being faithful. Right? So you die and you go down into the grave. What then? What happens? Are you conscious of what is happening in the grave? The Bible says that there is no repentance in the grave. The thoughts of those who go down to the grave, they perish. But then when resurrection happens, what happens? The very first face you see, it's a reverse. So it goes, the Bible says that this corruption must put on incorruption. And this mortal must put on immortality. So we go down corrupted, we stay in the grave, we sleep in the dust from which we were made of. But when the trumpet song, for those of us who remain faithful to God, we raise differently.
In an instant.
In an instant. Right? We raise up incorruptible, immortal. Right? In a glorified body. Right? And the very first thing we see, the first face we behold is the face of our loving Jesus. This is the hope that we need to have so that when death comes knocking at my door or your door, we can say, Lord Jesus, take me, I am yours. You know, it may sound like an easy thing for us to stand here and say, but when death takes hold of a person, you don't know the thoughts going through some people's mind. But if we live in constant unity with Christ, Sister Morgan, if we continue to hold on and trust in Jesus, Brother Wong Lee, Sister Olivier, Sister Thomas, if we continue, we have this hope that though we die, we will be resurrected to newness of life.
Amen. Amen.
And live forever and ever with Jesus. Eden will be restored, and all that God that had made that was perfect before sin raised its ugly head will again be made perfect.
Amen. We're going to take Brother Morgan, then Brother Top, then I'm going to give my closing and then Brother Woman will close.
Now, Sister Top asks a question. Did Job's wife had a hope? You know, when two persons live together for a long time, they became one, the Bible says they became one. And Job's wife saw her husband suffering all of that, because it's not easy for a spouse to see another one suffering the pain and heartache and problem that he's going through. Maybe that's why she uttered those words, why don't you curse God and die? Is not that she was, because in the latter end, Job have 10 children with the same wife. The Bible didn't tell you that Job married another woman. So the same wife he had, he did not leave his wife. I believe the pain that Job's wife saw her husband going through, she could not bear it. She lashed out. Why don't you curse God and die? And Job's response was, you speak like a foolish one. As you rightly said, he did not condemn her. Speak like a foolish one. The pain that she saw her husband going through probably was too much.
Okay. Top.
Mark, let me just say a little part on that. If you check Job 1, Satan already tell God that if he take away Job's blessing, he will curse him to his face. So Satan really tell Job's wife to tell God to curse him. But I want to, I see that the lesson going to end, and we didn't speak anything about those who will be resurrected. Because I see in the quarterly, he speak about when Christ comes, there are righteous people will resurrect, and there will be some wicked people who will be resurrected too. I want you all to tell a little bit on that.
Well, we have the doctrine from when you read Revelation, or even Jesus when he says, blessed are those who have part in the first resurrection. That is the resurrection unto life. The resurrection unto death, which is eternal death, is there would be two resurrections happening 1,000 years apart from each other. If we know our theology well, we would realize that that is what's going to happen. The first resurrection happens when Jesus returns to take his faithful people home. Then those who are dead, those who are living that are wicked, we teach will be slain by the brightness of his coming. Isn't that so? Yeah. Right? They remain dead for 1,000 years while the saints go to heaven to reign with Jesus for 1,000 years. Then there would be the resurrection of the wicked to meet their reward. Revelation 22:12 says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. And we believe that when Jesus said, he put some on his left and some on his right, and he said, come ye blessed of my Father, and then he said, curse are you into everlasting torment. This is where the two resurrection comes in, Brother Top, right? And we have to end the lesson, eh? We can't go on, eh?
And towards the lessons, down to the last part, speak about that some people will rise with Christ, some to shame and disgrace. Some will have to, those who pierce Christ, who
will see him pierce, coming, yes.
Yes, those who involve in Christ's crucifixion. I learned that these people who mock him and so on, and pierce his side and so on, these people, Christ will raise them to see him. So these are the part I was looking
yes,
at.
Yes.
Okay. But at top I understand, and we're going to have to address this another time, because in the essence of time, we need to wrap up.
Yeah.
Okay? The reason I brought the question earlier about faith, hope, and I've wondered is, why those three things? What's the connection between these three things, faith, hope, and love? And is there significance in the order? And this is my personal opinion. I might be wrong. Sister Morgan, good to see you. I was hoping I could invite you to make a comment. For you to have hope, you have to have faith. You must be a brother. I mentioned earlier, Abraham trusted. And because he trusted God, he understood about the resurrection. You have to have faith in order to have hope. And if you look at it, when I spoke to Kim about this morning, she mentioned the fact that God loves, so he gives us hope. But I want to bring this home to us. When I learn to trust God, I have faith in him. I can have hope that what he says in his word with the resurrection will happen. But here's the thing I want to tie in here. For me to be able to appreciate through faith and with the hope he's given me, all that he's promised me, and I want us to go back and read the last paragraph in the conclusion. It speaks about what will happen after the resurrection. For me to be able to appreciate with faith and hope what God has blessed me with, I must love him enough to do what he asks. I must love him enough to make sure that, as Brother Bowman mentioned earlier, that we are part of the first resurrection. And the only way that's going to happen is that because of my love for him, I willingly do what he asks. And I want just what this last line. The hope, my friends, is not in the resurrection. Think about that. The hope is not in the resurrection, but what will happen after the resurrection in heaven. Brother Bowman.
Now, I just want to read the last paragraph on the Friday. It says the life giver will call up his purchased possession in the first resurrection, and until the that triumphant hour when the last trump shall sound and the vast army shall come forth to eternal victory, every sleeping saint will be kept in safety and will be guarded as a precious jewel, who is known to God by name, by the power of the Savior that dwell in them while living, and because they were partakers of the divine nature, they were brought forth from the dead.
Amen.
So the thing is that we have hope, not as the unrighteous, but we have this hope. And as Paul says, we will not have you ignorant concerning those that are asleep, because God will raise them up at the last day. When that trumpet sound, it is my prayer that I am there. I am hoping that it is your prayer that you will be there also.
Amen.
Amen. Let me thank everyone who took part in Sabbath school this morning, making it possible. And at this time, to bring our Sabbath school to a close, I'll just ask you to stand as I ask Sister Top to pray for us this morning to bring Sabbath school to a close.
Good morning, church. It's good to be here this morning. It's good to, when we have such lovely discussions on the Word of God, I want to encourage you to continue studying your quarterly. Make it a conscious effort to revise, to go into the Word of God, even as you go about your day-to-day errands. Now, I wanted to talk to you about some things that are coming up from next Sabbath. Now, we will be going back into our Sabbath school classes from next Sabbath. Okay? So these discussions will be done in classes. We'll be having three classes. The Sabbath school will be broken up into three classes. Class one and two, those are the two classes that were over here, will be combining into one class, okay? And the persons assigned to those class to facilitate are Elder Clayton Olivier, Elder Eric Febuary, and Elder Garfield Bowman. Then we have class three and class four. They will be separately, one in front, one at the back. Class three will remain, now you will remain in your classes, those persons who were there. We have some persons who we will have to allot to classes, new converts and so on, right? So class three will remain class three, and that will be the class up front, and the persons attached to those classes, the facilitators are Elder Laurel Thomas. No, that's class four, sorry. Class three, the persons attached are Brother Elder Samuel Morgan, Elder Melville Brung, and Elder Norman Thorpe. And class four, that will be the class at the back. Persons attached to those class are Elder Laurel Thomas, Sister Beulah Mapp, sorry Sister Mapp, I didn't come to you, and Brother Harold Bullock. Yeah, Brother Harold Bullock. Now, I've spoken to most of the teachers, most of the persons. If you have an issue, right, the persons who I may not, you can tell me immediately so that we can make adjustment immediately. So, again, Next Sabbath, we're going back to classes. Secondly, our Sabbath school will be going back to a 9:15 start. We'll be going back to a 9:15 start. We're starting at 9:30. Now, we're looking to start our lesson discussion at about 10 to 10. That's when it's supposed to start. So we will have a full lesson discussion in place. Okay, and we wouldn't be ending the lesson discussion at 5 to 11 and so on. So at 9:15 next Sabbath, we're starting our Sabbath school. I hope that we will be here early as we fellowship with each other, as we fellowship with God. And remember to do your lesson study. May God continue. Yeah. Oh, sorry, I forgot this part. Yes, we will have a class. The class in front here will be doing the streaming of the lesson study. So next Sabbath, this class, Brother Thorpe, your class, will be carrying the stream for the lesson study. Okay, so the mic will be at your class, and it will, no, we wouldn't be hearing the mic in church, so don't worry about that. Good. Any questions from anyone? Any other question? Okay, talk to you guys. Yes, brother. Oh, Brother Thorpe, brother, oh, because of the camera location, Brother Batiste is asking that the streaming take place on this side. So, I will be starting the streaming with your class, Brother Thorpe, so I may have to ask you to move over on this side. And we'll ask the class, senior one, to move back to the back. Okay? Good. Next week, Sabbath, we will think. All the best for the rest of the day as we continue to worship the Lord. And I must welcome the Robinson family as they come in and they're fellowshipping with us today. Amen? Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good to see you at church today. And I believe our stream, we had some little technical difficulties, but it's up and running, so you can let your friends, neighbors, loved ones know that we are live. CalderSDA.org. I have a few announcements for us. Firstly, this afternoon our EY program would be the finals in the public speaking, and it begins at 3:30. It will be at the Maranatha SDA Church. You know that is a small church, so the link will be posted in our church chat and on our website, CalderSDA.org. So that's our AY this afternoon at 3:30 in the PM. Tomorrow, Pastor Franklin father-in-law funeral service will take place at the Greg's SDA Church. Funeral service is at 1 p.m. Viewing begins at 12. Please remember the Williams family in prayer. Unfortunately, Sister Rodney fell and hurt herself. So she wasn't here last Sabbath and she's unable to be here. So please remember Sister Rodney in prayer. As was mentioned earlier, Brother Garfield Bowman's mom got a stroke this morning and is hospitalized. Please remember her in prayer. We've also learned of the death of Mr. Alan Dean. died last night. I ask that you remember the family in prayer. Whew. Next Sabbath, some more better news now. Next Sabbath, as was mentioned before, we begin our service at 9:15 and this will continue. So we are going back to our 9:15 service and this will continue weekly. And at just after Sabbath school, next Sabbath, we will begin our 2023 officers election process. So please be here so that you can cast a vote for the large committee to start the process of election 2023 for our officers. We would like to visit Pastor Neversa Crusade at Walveru. We're hoping to do so tomorrow night and Friday night. Now we wanna take a bus there either tomorrow night or Friday night. So I'm gonna do quickly is ask for a short indication of those who would need transportation to go tomorrow night and Friday night. So we'll decide which night we can take the bus or if we can take the bus both nights. For those who need transportation, I know those of us who have private vehicles will go along tomorrow night and Friday night. Anybody who would need transportation? Okay, so we will all take private transportation tomorrow night, and we can do some carpooling tomorrow night, and on Friday night we will take the bus. But please see me or send a message to me by Wednesday night, or when we be here on Wednesday night, so we'll know exactly if we need to take a bus or we'll carpool again. All right, so that's Crusade tomorrow night at Walveru. And you know where Walveru is? It's the old airport. We are turning at what we call the moon, like we're going down to come into college. I mean, technical college, sorry. So we're going down that way. Just opposite where Coates Warehouse is. Right, correct. So the Crusade is taking place just opposite where Coates Warehouse is, down Walveru. On the 6th of November, we'll be having the Move to Live. And that program has been renamed. We know it as the Hands Across the Caribbean. So the Move to Live will take place on the 6th of November. And we are asked to take part as a church. There'll be numerous categories. Okay, Move to Live. Yes, November 6th, 2022. So there'll be challenges. There'll be challenges, physical challenges. There'll be football. There'll be cricket. There'll be tug of war. I mean, just name it. There'll be athletics. There will be relay. So plan to be there. See Sister Josie and John to register. If you want to play football, if you want to play cricket, and females will be involved. So there will be mixed team, male and female. We're going to have fun on that day, November the 6th. So keep that date in mind. And I think I missed the location. I do not have that location as yet. Not confirmed as yet. Yes. For the correspondent that came out, the location was not confirmed as yet. And finally, I think I missed one. The funeral The funeral for Sister Thomas, that's Shoma Thomas, will take place on the 30th of October. Now, Jaden's son will depart Kingston at 7 a.m. with stops to Bekwe, Kanawan, and Mairo, and we return the next day, which is Monday, at 6:30 in the a.m. So that's for those who will be attending Sister Thomas' funeral. Now, the return fare for Jaden's son, the regular fare is $160, but for this funeral, the return fare because of this funeral is $160. So it's a special, it's $160. Now the regular fare one way is $120. So you know it's definitely a special. So if you're planning to be there at Sister Thomas' funeral next Sunday in Union Island, you can catch Jaden's son at 7 a.m. on Sunday morning and return next morning at 6:30 in the a.m. And Brother Rangul's funeral will also take place on the 30th at the Richland Park Seventh-day Adventist Church at 1 in the p.m. Funeral will be at 12. Viewing will be at 12. I think these are all the announcements. Let us prepare for our divine service at this time. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Yes, I'm going to invite all of us to stand as we, this week on Thursday, we will be celebrating our 43rd year of independence in St. Vincent and Grenadines. We're going to invite you to stand as we invite the praise team to come and sing our national anthem at this time as a mark of respect for our country. 43 years of independence. So wherever possible that we can stand, I know some might not be able to stand, understandable. So let's all stand where possible. We can have our national anthem at this time.
St. Vincent land so beautiful, we joyful hearts we pledge to thee for loyalty and love and hope to keep you ever free. Whatever future brings, our faith will see us through.
you very much. Please be seated.
Let's all stand as we continue with hymn number 92. This is my Father's world. Number 92.
Psalms. Let us turn to Psalms, and together we'll read two verses. These two verses of this beautiful Psalms, Psalms 117. Psalms 117. I want to ask you to join me as I read. Psalms 117. Let's begin. Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye people, for his merciful kindness is great towards us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord. At this point in time, I ask us to prepare our hearts as we seek the Lord in prayer.
Throne when grace does abound. May
Holy Father Almighty Yahweh, this morning again, help us to be very thankful for your mercies and your grace. I ask of you now again, forgive us of our sins, even as you have forgave those of old. Wash us thoroughly. Let no iniquity be found within us. Help us to put away our stiff-necked ways, and help that we'll humble ourselves before thee, that we'll be able to serve you in spirit and in truth, with all our heart, mind, and soul. This time, I bring all of our brethren before you, near and far, those who have accepted you as Lord and Master. May help that we may continue to do as you have asked us to do. Continue to remind us that we are living in borrowed time, and help us to be sober, even at this time. I bring our backsliding brethren before you even at this time. May let your words reach their ears again, that they will come and accept you as Lord and Master, and escape the wrath that is about to come upon the face of the earth. May you continue to remind us what you are doing in the mercy seat for us even at this time. Help us to be awake before the time is past, before it shall announce it is finished. I bring those in our communities who have heard your words but refuse to accept. And there are those who are desirous to hear your words, to find some way out, to be comforted, and to worship the living God. Let your message reach to them. Give them an opportunity, even move the force of darkness from among them, that they can have an opportunity to make a decision whether they want to follow you or not. This morning, I ask for unity among us as brethren. I bring every one of our pastors before you. May bless them, pour out your Holy Spirit upon them as they pray one for another and pray for us, and as we pray for them. Your Holy Spirit that you promised to pour out upon all flesh will come upon us. And those who are looking on and the life that we live, they can be able to be comforted and want to live as we live. I bring sick ones before you this time. Mention of Sister Rodney and Sister Bowman, and there are others. All powers are in thine hands, and we know all things are possible with thee, to make well again and to comfort even in time like this. We are saying thanks. I say unto you, I thank you for our very existence, and to keep us alive even up to this time. Oh, help us not to be ungrateful, but to remember to give you praise and thanks continually for every blessings that you have bestowed upon us. In times like now, as the temptation and difficulties come upon us, help us not to sink down beneath these things, but as brethren, we encourage one another in times like now before you come. Lord, today we speak about independence, although we are not fully independent yet. But I say unto you that thou may help us to that day when we shall all be with you, to live in peace, where there will be no more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more big bills to pay, no more crying, and all these things will be over. Thank you, you have already paid the price for us. And help us not to be foolish and stupid to lose these things that you have already granted unto us. Thank you for that sacrifice, that blood that would have shed, all those things that you would have gone through for us, that we should have life eternal. Help us to see the price that before us. And as these roads get more narrow and more twisted and steeper, as your coming is closer, help us to endure to the end. At this time, I bring thy man servant before you, even Elder February. Anoint him again afresh as he speak your words to us and those who are listening wheresoever they may be, that as your word reach our ears, it will bring warning and comfort to us. And then we shall be able to go to our home rejoicing, knowing that we have hope, we have confidence, and all our sins have been washed away. Thank you, O great God. May continue to bless us with hope. There are those who are in their home who are sick, and there are those in hospitals. There are some who have gone to work, but they are not feeling well. I say unto you, consider our cry. Hear our prayer. There are those where war are fighting. Our brethren, they are running, they are fleeing for their life. There are people who are filling the prison up, young women and men. Lord, many are hooked on drugs, some are stealing and all manner of evil. I beg of thee, consider our prayers as we pray for our children, our grand-in-laws, brethren. Into your hands I commit all these things, O great one. I beg you, in the name of the beloved one, even Yahshua, hear and answer our prayers. Let the church say amen.
At this time, I ask the deacon and deaconess to come forward. For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. If I were hungry, I would not tell thee, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Psalms 50, verses 10 and 12. The deacon and deaconess will now wait on us for tithes, offerings, and gifts.
We'll sing God Bless Our Homeland, Fair Isle of the Carib Sea.
Peace out.
worthy but thine own.
And let's all stand.
Me give thee but thine own, whatever gifts may be, all that we have is thine alone, and trust, O Lord, from thee.
Let's pray. The great and heavenly Father, I want to thank you once more for giving us strength so we can go out and work and earn a living, O God. And as we return a portion of thy blessing, I ask that we be used to bless others, O God, and to further thy work in this part of the vineyard. Is my prayer in Jesus' holy name. Amen. At this time, we will go into our health nugget.
In Genesis chapters 1 through 3, we not only read about the creation of our world, but we also learn how to stand for wellness. Water, exercise, live temperately, love, nutrition, environment, sunshine, thought life, air, nature, dress, sufficient rest, and simple trust in God. In this nugget, we want to focus on the first way to stand for wellness, which is water. In Genesis 1 and verse 2, we read, "The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." We see that when the world began, it was in essence water. All life on earth is dependent upon water for its existence. The human body itself is made of approximately 60% of water by weight, and proper health depends upon a steady source of pure water, and without it, a healthy adult would die in a few days. You and I, as adults, need about 1 ounce of water for every 2 pounds that we weigh. But if you are sweating, and if you are sick with a fever, vomiting, or diarrhea, you need to drink more. But in general, just remember 1 ounce of water for every 2 pounds that you weigh. The fact is, your body is made up of trillions of cells, and each of these cells require water in order to carry out its functions. Your body is not made of 60% Coca-Cola, milk, or orange juice. When God created Adam and Eve, he placed them in the Garden of Eden. There wasn't a river of milk, a lake of Mountain Dew, or waterfalls of apple juice. God chose the best for us, water. Among other things, water helps to remove waste products, keeps your blood volume expanded, it prevents headaches, helps prevent constipation, lubricates your joints, and helps maintain a youthful look of your skin, and improves cognition or thinking. Water is not only beneficial inside your body, but its external application can be very therapeutic. Bathing daily and keeping clean is important, but applications of hot and cold water on the skin over joints or infected parts of the body can decrease the pain and swelling and can increase immune system function. Taking a 20-minute hot foot bath when you start to feel sick can help ward off the illness. In John 4, 13 and 14, we learn about another type of water. It states, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water, springing up into everlasting life. This water is Christ, living in you, making you like him. I want that water, don't you?" God bless you abundantly as you learn to stand for wellness.
Remember to drink your water. At this time, we will have our children's corner. We're asking all the children to come forward as we sing the song, "I'm a promise, I'm a possibility." And as they come, and we'll have the story on the screen. It's coming out of Jamaica, one of our churches in Jamaica.
Things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Hi, boys and girls, good morning. And it is your time. Yes, it is children's story time. And this morning, I know that you can see that we are in a different environment. Now, what do you think our story for today is going to be? Anyone can guess? What do you think it is? Right, I want you to put it in the chat, or you can raise your hand. Our story for today is the story of creation. What's the title of our story? What are we going to be looking at? The story of creation. Now, boys and girls, long, long time ago, before the world began, now this earth was filled with darkness. And God said, you know what? I am going to create light. I'm going to allow light to be in this darkness. And on the first day, God created light. God created what? Yes, God created light. No, God created light. After he would have created the light, God said, you know what? He's going to allow the sea to be parted. And when he parted the sea, guess what appeared? What are we walking on? Yes, dry land appeared. So after the dry land appeared, then God created the trees, all of these trees that we are seeing. God created the trees, he created fruits. Yes, he created all of these plants. He created the beautiful flowers. He created the beautiful flowers so that we can see them and we can put it and decorate our homes. Right, he also created plants so that we can eat. And I'm sure that you are able to see the aki tree. Now, after he would have created them, God was pleased. He said, yes, I am happy with what I have done so far. And because he was so happy, he created two lights. Now, I know that you must know what these two lights are. What do you think these two lights are? Type them in the chat. Hold up your hand and let me know. Right. He created the sun and he created the moon. Excellent. And we know that the sun, we see it in the day, and the moon in the night. So those were the lights that God created, those two special lights.
Now, after he would have created the lights, he said, you know what? I've created all of these things thus far. I must fill this world. I must fill the land with creatures. So God created the creatures. He created animals of all kinds. Can you think of an animal that he created? The elephants, the giraffes, the fishes, yes, the birds flying in the air. Yes, God created all of those animals. Even the little puppy that we have at home, God created those animals for us. He said, I am so happy for all of these things that I would have done. And because he's so happy, he said, you know what? I'm going to create some persons. And God created people. The first persons that he created were Adam and Eve. And I know that we all know about Adam and Eve. They were the first persons that God created. Now, something very bad happened in this creation story. So while God created Adam and Eve, they lived in the beautiful garden. And while they were there, they looked after the plants and the animals. They were in charge of all of that what God had created. And don't forget something that is so special. After he created everything, and he said, you know what? This is good. This is beautiful. God rested on the seventh day. Yes, God rested on the seventh day. Now, boys and girls, it is early time and we're going to be resting today. Now, the title of our story, as I said before, was the creation story. Now, we know all about creation. We can hear the birds chirping in the distance. We can see the beautiful trees. And we are living testimonies that God created us. Now, I want us to remember this creation story as we go on all through the week, and let us share it with our friends. But before we go, we must do something. We must give God thanks for what he has created. So let us pray. Let us pray, boys and girls. Your hands are clasped. Your eyes are closed, everyone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to give you thanks for today. Lord, we thank you so much for your creation. Thank you for your 6 days that you have created the earth. And thank you, Lord, for the seventh day where we can rest and bask in what you have created and to give you thanks. We ask, Lord, that you may be with each and every one of these children. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much, boys and girls, for listening. Thank you for coming out for our children's story today. I will see you next week. Bye!
All right. Thank you very much. It's my privilege to say a hearty welcome to one and all. Welcome, church. To those who have been online, it's good to join us today. I hope that you experience Sabbath day's blessings in a special way. We want to welcome the visitors among us. And as I look around from this vantage point, we do have a few visitors. Feel welcome. And I pray that you are feeling the way that you're looking, for you're looking well. And you have come, okay, experience the blessings of God's Sabbath, and thanks for being here today. Enjoy the fellowship. Welcome one, welcome all. Our speaker for today is no stranger to us. It's one of our own local elder, Desmond Febuary, a teacher by profession, a man who loves the Lord, man who's accustomed standing at this pulpit. He's comfortable doing it. Okay? But before Elder February speaks to us, I'll invite the praise team to come forth and to lead us in some wonderful singing. Praise team.
This morning, we praise our Creator God, and we invite you to join with us as we worship him today, the one who made us, gave us purpose, And even though from time to time we go against his will, he doesn't leave us in our mess. He comes and he gets us. He forgives us. He restores us. Hallelujah. We turn to number two, all creatures of our God and King, as we join with all creation today and worship. Number two.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and hymns and sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, burning sun with golden beam, and silver moon with softer gleam. Jesus, ruler of all nature.